Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon. Good evening, wherever you're calling in from. And welcome to this week's Hump Day Coffee Break. This is a weekly meeting that I do with my email subscribers. 15-minute presentation, quick and dirty, followed by Q&A. And I'm really happy to have with us Emeric, the founder and CEO of Agora Pulse. Now, Agora Pulse is basically a social media management tool. I love it because of its analytics, and it has so many features in it for Facebook, and they're rolling out a few. I'm not going to reveal anything, but it's a really great tool to check out, and they have a free Facebook benchmarking tool as well that we're going to talk about. So with that, I'm going to pass it over to Emeric.
Thank you, John. I'm very happy to be invited to share some of my thoughts with you guys. So today, you asked me to talk about how to get more engagement on Facebook, and I wanted to take the scope a little bit. I wanted to take a little bigger picture of that, which is basically if you want to get better engagement on Facebook and increase that engagement on Facebook, you have to reach more people and get the right content in front of them. So I thought I feel more comfortable into taking, you know, looking at the big picture and talking more about the content strategy and how you can come up with the one that will get you the reach and the engagement that you're looking for. So that's my topic today. The first thing I wanted to show you, which is our free tool, which you can find at barometer.agorapulse.com, and basically it's all about reach and engagement on your Facebook page. You can install the Facebook page for free, and then the nice thing about it, it takes your last 50 posts, and it will give you the average fan reach, engagement, organic reach, PTAT, which is kind of not used anymore today, but shares, comments, and likes, negative feedback, clicks, and all that stuff. And you can see your numbers, the average number for your last 50 posts, and compare that number with the average number for that metric for the pages in the barometer that have the same size as yours. And as you can see here, we have 8,700 pages. Knowing that a page will stay on the system for 2 months, then the token expires. So that gives you an ID, some kind of an ID of, okay, am I doing above the average page out there, or am I doing below? And the example on that screen is pretty interesting. That's a page about the political issues, and as you can guess from the name, it's more on the Democrat side than the Republican side. And you can see that their reach number, as for a lot of people, is not very significant. It's pretty low, 5% organic, which would look like not such a great number for most people, but the engagement is pretty high, 10%. They are above average. So that tells them something about, okay, we're not reaching a lot of people. Maybe it's because of Facebook algorithm and changes and stuff, but the engagement is still very high. So the content is resonating with the audience. We're doing a good job. Basically what I want to go through with you is the eight types of content you can post on Facebook, and I've listed them here: the memes, product, service, center content, useful content, which is basically evergreen, blog post, ebook, webinars. You're probably pretty much familiar with all these type of content. Casual, people-centered content, I'll get to that later, and conversational, evergreen, and others people content, which is basically curation. Going with the meme, so this may sound like, yeah, memes are not for brands or not for businesses, but actually a lot of people in the field, Kim Garst being one of them, leverage those memes pretty efficiently by sharing insightful quotes or inspiring quotes, and for some it works. I know for my brand it's not really in line with the tone and the personality of my brand, so I don't use them, but I didn't want to let them out of the list, because I know that for some people it is a good match and a good fit with the kind of personality and the kind of messages they want to share. So this is the first type. The second type of content is the product-centered content. So basically the product-centered content is the one that probably comes to your mind at first. It's like, yeah, let's talk about my stuff, my services, my product. And it, you know, because everybody out there says don't talk about yourself and don't sell on social, doesn't mean that you shouldn't be sharing content related, product-related content about what you do and sell. And I'm going to show you some results that we've been getting. For example, here, That was a post about one of our latest features that was interesting enough, in our opinion, to be shared with the audience. And we want, you know, we use Facebook and social in general to let our audiences there know that, hey, we have that great new feature, check it out. So that's the second type.
This is one of my favorite features. This is one of my favorite features. Because it instantly makes a social media manager look like a rock star in front of executives.
Yeah, it does, because you get that nice, good-looking, professional-looking PowerPoint in just one click, and it saves you a lot of time. That's the one thing that people like the most about. The next one is about people-centered, or it's about you. It's about your team. It's the next slide. I don't know. Yeah, it's about your team. It's about who you are as people behind the brand, behind the product, behind the service. So I just took that example because we bought an Anki drive from Apple. Apple's not selling them. You can buy them at Apple stores. Very fun tool, toy. We played around with it with the team, and I did a little video for Christmas. And hey, we've been playing Anki drive. So this type of content is not going to drive sale. It's not going to drive business, but it's going to drive sympathy. It's going to drive your audience looking at you, not a brand selling products and trying to push these products on them. It's gonna make you look like a bunch of guys who are having fun and we're not that different from the audience they're talking to. So it's also an important type of content. And if you read, which I advise you to do, Kim Garth's latest book about be authentic and be the real you, stand, please stand up, which is it's a great book. It's all about that. It's all about you and how you can be you on social, and this type of content is what it's about. The next type of content is the conversational content. One guy who is doing a great job at that is Brian Carter. I do encourage you to check his Facebook page. He keeps starting those crazy conversation and people engage like crazy because it's fun. And because he knows how to trigger those conversations, so he does it very well. So, and that's the type of content you are expecting: responses, feedback. What do you think? Oh, this is what Facebook is doing with this new release. Are you angry or happy? You know, that kind of stuff. And this is again not going to drive your business. Not going to talk about you and who you are, but get those conversations started and that community sense more present on your Facebook page. The next one is the evergreen content. So the evergreen content is usually your own content, mostly your own content, hopefully. Maybe you've published it a year ago, 2 years ago, but it's still valid today. And that evergreen, the good thing you should be doing with that evergreen content is repost it on a regular basis. And one guy who's doing a very good job at that is John Loomer. And John is posting, 6-month-old, a year-old blog post, sometimes older than that, on his Facebook page on a regular basis. And he has seen consistent engagement even on old posts and consistent engagement that was not lower than recent content. So if your content is evergreen and the piece of content you wrote a year ago is still as valid today as it was a year ago, do not hesitate to repost it, maybe with a different angle, with a different description, but it's still going to work. So that's another source of content for you to leverage on your Facebook page to increase the number of content you can post and increase engagement and reach. The next one is about curation. So curation is about sharing other people's content. And the reason why curation is important is because of basically curation is important because of two reasons. The first one is it is hard to come up with a consistent flow of great content on a daily or a weekly basis. It's very hard. It takes a lot of time and it requires a lot of investment. So sharing other people's great content is a way to keep nurturing that content feed without having to create all of it. But the second reason, which probably is the most important, is because it makes you not be about the me marketing, like we call it. The me marketing is everything I write, everything I share is about me, myself, my brand, my company, my story, my journey. And the curation side of things allows you to say, hey, I'm not only focusing on my stuff. I'm also showing you other people's stuff, which I think is relevant, which I think will help you, which I think will make a difference interest and be of interest to you. So I think it's very important to do that. But one of the tools I'm using is BuzzSumo, which you can see on that screenshot. That's why I used it here. I use BuzzSumo to identify the content that in my niche for my keyword. So you can see here I did a search for Facebook marketing. And for Facebook marketing for the past week, it's going to show me all the blog posts by number of shares. So I can see the ones that got the most shares and which presumably are the most interesting ones for the audience. So you have to balance that with the audience of the blog. So if you have a very big blog, they'll naturally have a tendency to have more shares than a smaller blog. So you have to look at the kind of blog and say, okay, it's logic that this one has 2,000 shares because it's Social Media Examiner, for example. But you know, so you don't look at those share numbers as the whole thing. Use some insights about the size of the blog and the size of their audience to see if it is very interesting because of the size or the topic of the content. So that's the curation tool I'm using the most. The next type, what's the next type of content? Yeah, I just can't switch. I'm so sorry for that. So we've gone through the eight types of content. The one thing that's really important that to get the best content strategy and reach an engagement on Facebook, we need to come up with the right mix among these types of contents. It can be only curation, because if you do only curation, you're not going to get any traffic to your content and you're not going to create any awareness for your own stuff and your own content and your own product, so it's not good. If you're only posting conversational or fun pics, you know, you're getting no business. If you're only talking about you, hey, this is who I am, this is what I like, this is my team, this is Christelle for my support, doesn't she look great today? Same thing. You'll get sympathy. People will be sympathetic, but you will get no business. And if you're only talking about the business, you know, people will lose interest. They'll go away and say, oh, these people keep trying to sell me their stuff, and I don't like that. So it's about the right mix. It's about having the right balance between all these types of messages and all these types of content. On the next slide, I shot that next slide from my Facebook ad report interface, as you can recognize it. And basically, I wanted to share it with you because these are all Facebook ads I've done. And the last one is a post I did on the page that's promoted that I promoted to my clients that was announcing the launch of our new Twitter management feature last summer. And as you can see, I paid $31 to promote that post. And I acquired 3 paid clients at a cost of $10 per new client for that very post. And so the numbers are small, yes, but just so you know, acquiring a client through a cold sale on Facebook ads or AdWords is usually costing me between $60 and $75 minimum. So I have a lifetime value of at least $400, so that's okay. But with a lifetime value of $400, if I can acquire a new client for $10, I have a pretty good ROI right here. And this was just by using content on Facebook that I promoted. So, and obviously, as you can guess, that was the product service type of content. And finally, on the last slide, the key takeaways here, it's not about one metric. You know, don't look at just reach or just engagement or just ROI, because if you do, you're gonna be disappointed. It's, again, as much as is it about the mix of content and the right mix of content, the targets you should have in mind and the goals you should have in mind should be a mix of that. Because if you get reach on some posts, engagement on some others, clicks on some others, then you'll get ROI on the one that are supposed to get ROI. But if you're trying to get ROI on each of the posts, you're going to kill ROI, basically. So it's again, here, for the metric, it's also a mix. Don't try to nail them all for each post. Try to keep that mix in mind. It's about having resources to create the right content strategy. So I'm telling you, I'm not going to give you an EBS. It takes us a lot of time, and we do invest a lot in our content strategy and social being part of that content strategy and that content promotion strategy. So if you cannot do that if you have no resources, resources being time or money. It is very important to to decide on some resources, and if the resources are small, then go for small goals, and don't try to overachieve something you don't have the means to follow up with or to carry on. And I don't know where is the last slide. It's gone again. No, it's
not the last one is, sorry, Emeric, it's right here. Key takeaways.
Okay. And yeah, and it's about leveraging that content strategy outside of Facebook too. So we've gone through Facebook and that Facebook content, but obviously you don't want to limit yourself to Facebook, because all that content is an investment, and that investment should be leveraged on as many places as possible. You know, having a blog is a must-have, and I know, John, you'll need to be convinced of that. And you know, learning to leverage Twitter, which is a totally different beast, is also very important for that content strategy, reach and engagement. And I'm just starting to look at Pinterest. To be honest with you, I've not been very good at that, but I'm starting to look at Pinterest because it seems that there is a lot of potential if you invest a bit more in the visual assets that you're producing, and you can produce a lot of visual assets out of your existing written content. So, you know, look beyond Facebook. Facebook's great. I love Facebook, but it would be kind of a waste if I was only focusing my content promotion in my promotion period on Facebook only. So that's my message.
Wow.
I've been fast enough, maybe too fast for some.
No, Emeric, this has really been great. Can I just go over a couple questions, because there were a few that people asked, and then Emeric has to leave at 11:25, so it's going to be a hard stop at 11:25. I'm happy to stay and ask questions, but Emeric is going to jump off. So let me just go here and – okay, beautiful. So let me just see here. Oh, Katie asks a good question. Should memes or funny pictures be cited? And I answered privately. I said – it's not really necessary to apply attribution, because usually when you find a meme, if you're just searching around, you see something quote unquote going viral, usually if the person creating it, they usually have an attribution on the picture itself. So I don't think people need to worry so much about, oh, where did I get this? I need to assign attribution. If it's a meme, that's different from, you know, so for example, if you see this on, you know, Facebook, something like that, you know, usually there's some sort of attribution or logo right on that if a business is doing it. So here's an example right here. And Kim Garst is really good about that. On a lot of her memes, she'll put this little logo on it as well. So you don't necessarily have to worry about the attribution part. That's my, but then again, I'm not a lawyer. Emeric, do you want to add anything to that?
No, I'd say, yeah, if there's a logo in there, like the one Kim is putting on all of them, you're just fine, because that's her goal. She wants you to share the images with the logos on them, so she'll be happy. If it's a citation, if it's a quote for someone, well, obviously that quote belongs to that person, so you can take that quote and recreate your own visual using Canva, for example, and you don't have to give attribution to anyone. So I'd say the attribution issue is usually not the biggest issue for these.
Yeah. And Norman is just making a comment. He says, per your comment on last week's trends session, we had a meeting on nonprofit trends for 2015. Most organizations should budget for Facebook ads. Then that's a question mark. And I say yes. And you say right here, you know, in order for you to operate as a business, you have to buy Facebook ads to push out content. And obviously you're looking at that investment as well. You know, what's your goal? And here, you got this ROI right here. You acquired 3 customers for $10. Lifetime value overall is going to be $1,200 for those 3 customers. So that's a huge ROI.
Yeah, it's, again, we have a lot of examples like this. I just took that screenshot because I had it in the previous PowerPoint. But yes, it is. The one thing you need to understand is, among the 8 pieces of content, the one that really deserves promotion is the one about your product and services. Basically, to give you a rule of thumb, I don't promote anything that's about us as a team and as people, because I don't think it's worth it. I don't promote memes. I basically only promote my content, in which I put usually between $40 and $50 for each post on Facebook that's about one of my blog posts. And I basically spend $250 per blog post, whether it is external writers or time. and you know, not spending $40 to get that extra promotion would feel like a waste for me. So I'm happy to pay to get more eyeballs on that content. Hmm. And I get clicks and I can measure what I get, so I'm pretty happy with it.
Yeah.
It's more about not willing to waste it, basically, for me, promote it on Facebook. And then when I talk about the product or video demos or webinars I'm trying to get people on, then I'm ready to go up to the $100 and $120 per post. And that's where I see that kind of ROI.
Got it. Okay. And there's one more question from Chelsea that I see. Oh, by the way, Norman is pointing out that we only see 7 types of content. That's fine. We could just change this to 7.
Yes.
You know, maybe
I guess there
7.
Was one that I removed for. There was one from a previous deck that I removed for two days, and I forgot to change the number.
Oh, okay. Got it. So we'll just say 7. Okay.
My bad.
No worries.
At 1 a.m.
No worries.
Yesterday night, as you know, so I was a bit tired.
Yeah. No worries. I know. I do this a lot. I add a bunch of stuff, and then I get the number wrong. You know, it's a math. It's keeping your eyes open and staying awake. That's what that issue is. So Chelsea's asking, what metrics, data tools, et cetera, well, I'll just narrow this down. What metrics would you use to determine the right mix for the content strategy? What metric would you look at?
Well, the first metric I look at is what can I come up with? That's the first metric. It's my own limitation. So if you look at the evergreen, at my content, on my product, you know, obviously I'm not going to release a new feature every other day or even week. So I basically get a very good sense of what kind of content I can come up with with what timing. Then when we look at that, I would say, you know, the product and the service and whatever sales-oriented stuff shouldn't come in the mix more than 2 times out of 10, something like that. So definitely not 50%. That's too much.
Yeah.
And I'd say 1 out of 20 would make it hard to justify the 19 others you've spent time on just to get that one thing that's ROI, that has ROI potential. So,
yep.
You know, 20% is like. Sounds like a good rule of thumb.
Yeah, got it. No, that's great.
Then the people, it's every time I have something to say, every time I have someone to highlight or create a story. If I'm going to an event, for example, I'm going to have a lot of people-centered content for a week. And then maybe I won't have anything to say about for 2 weeks. So it's more about the opportunities. What's at the reach of my hand? What can I make happen today? If I don't have anything, I'm not going to create it for the sake of having some. So,
got it. Okay. Well, Emeric, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And one thing I'll just say is, you know, after you get off this webinar, I did share the slides. Make sure you go and you check out this barometer tool because it's really great to benchmark your page. You know, that would be my recommended next step after today's training meeting. So Emeric, thank you so much. And if anybody else has questions, I'm happy to stick around. If not, I will, you know, we'll finish up and we will, I'll post this recording and you'll get an email with a link to it on Monday. Okay.
And you can find me on Twitter. And if you have any further question you'd like to ask on Twitter, find me on Twitter and send them in 140 characters at @ERNOULT. I guess you can send that. Or write that somewhere.
Yeah, like this right here? It's like that?
Yeah. @ERNOULT. So that my first name and first letter of my first name and my last. Yes, that's it.
Got it. Okay, so that's it.
And you can ping me on Twitter. I may not respond before a couple of hours because I have a bunch of meetings, but I will respond. So do it.
Okay, awesome. Thank you so much, Emeric. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Okay.
Thank you, guys. Have a good day. Bye.
Thank you, everybody. I don't see any other questions, but thank you. Really appreciate that. I did send a link to the slides. I'll send those again right now very quickly. Let me just say I'm going to grab the slides. I'll post it right here and I'll send to all. So there's a link to the slides, the recording. I'll upload that. And then again, I'll send the email out on Monday, in Monday's newsletter. There's always a link. And that is it. Everybody have a great week and have a great weekend and stay warm if you are in the Northeast.